Hey, welcome. Please join us in worship. We're going to start with, we're here to worship.
Person of Jesus Christ, God showered his love down upon this world in the things that he taught us, in the healings that he did, and in a gift he gave to us on the last night of his life when he took bread from the table where he and friends were eating and gave thanks to God and then broke it and shared it with his friends saying, "Take and eat, this is now my body which is given for you. And whenever you do this, remember me." And later in the meal, he reached over and lifted up the common cup. And again, he shared it with his friends and he said, "Drink from this. This is my blood poured out for you and for many in the forgiveness of sins. And as often as you drink this, remember me." And so whenever we who are the followers of Christ gather, we eat from this meal, drinking from this cup, remembering the one who came only for you, each of you, and for all of you. Amen.
Only you and me here now. Chrissy.
And I'm Bob.
And you're watching The Wave. Vacation Bible Study is headed to Water's Edge Monday, Thursday, June 26th to June 29th from 9 a.m. to 12 noon. Mark your calendars and get ready for our children to take an amazing journey through the Maker Fun Factory, where they'll learn a lot about being created by God for a specific purpose. VBS enrollment is for children entering K through 5th grade, and we hope to include this same exciting experience for our preschool children as well. Opportunities to inspire a child and VBS registration information to follow. Contact Hollis Oselka with questions.
Grab a cup of coffee and join an ongoing adult Sunday school class, which meets on Sundays at 10 a.m. We are using the Upper Room Daily Devotional to look at a variety of scriptures and how they impact our lives. If you need a copy of the Upper Room, they are available in the Information Center in the Commons. Participation is open to everyone, and you may attend each week or whenever your schedule allows. The class meets in the couch room and will conclude in time to attend the 11 worship. You're invited to this journey to deepen your faith. We look forward to seeing you there.
Have you checked out our online giving platform? If you have an offering you'd like to make, head over to h2oedge.org/giving to give online. Also, if you want to give during worship today, there are offering boxes located at the rear of the worship center next to the tech booth. Thank you for supporting the ministries of Water's Edge through your giving. Now, let's recap what you need to know. The Maker Fun Factory Vacation Bible School is coming to Water's Edge June 26th to the 29th from 9 a.m. to noon.
Adult Sunday School is a great way to deepen your faith. It meets every Sunday at 10.
If you'd like to make an offering during worship today, offering boxes are located on each side of the tech booth as you exit, or go online to h2oedge.org.
Find out more about the ministries here at Water's Edge by going to h2oedge.org and make God take you to the edge.
Good morning. Join with me in prayer. Like the rarest of treasures, we search for you, O God, to find relationship that builds us up and sustains us and leads us forward. We pray this day as we begin to turn a chapter here at Water's Edge, to be a guiding presence in our going in and our coming out and in all of life. And may you sustain us for the journey ahead. Amen. Treasures from along the Strand. Strand is a word that comes to us out of actually the Middle English. It is that line where the water meets the beach. In other words, treasures from along the beach. This will be my last series with you as your pastor here at Water's Edge. And I thought maybe as a good way of concluding our time together over the next 6 weeks, I'd talk about some of the things that I have learned. Some of it I've learned from you, from living in our community, from that beautiful lake shore we have. But all of it I have learned ultimately from God, just as everything we learn in this life ultimately comes to us from God. Sometimes the lessons have been easily learned and absorbed. Sometimes the lessons have happened by the things I've done or tried to do. Sometimes the lessons have been learned by the mistakes that have been made. But it's all a part of that great experience of life, where if we lean into it, we're able to grow and develop and be nurtured throughout the journey. And so I hope you'll understand if I take 6 weeks to look at the last 24 years of my journey. And I want to begin, interestingly enough, with the moment I'm living in right now. Just so we all know the facts, in about 2 months' time, you'll be receiving a new pastor, Kel Penny, and his family. I've met with him several times, again, as recently as yesterday, a delightful family. And in about 2 months' time, I will be in my new appointment at First United Methodist Church of Holland. So I'm at a point in my life where I'm meeting a lot of new people. Now, the folks at the Holland Church that I meet, well, they know who I am, at least by virtue of my position as pastor. But I'm also starting to meet some other people in the Holland area. And I've been doing a little experiment, I guess maybe even having a little fun. Have you noticed when you meet somebody new, you'll introduce yourself? Hi, I'm Brad. And they'll say, hi, I'm, John Smith. And then after that, there's kind of this awkward pause. Well, okay, now we know each other's name. What do we talk about now? And the one thing that people tend to gravitate toward, I guess maybe because it feels safe and it's kind of easy to open up a discussion, is they'll tell people what they do. Hi, I'm Brad. I'm the pastor at Water's Edge. Or, hi, I'm John Smith. I'm, the owner of a small business here in town. So my little experiment has been this. As I've been meeting some new people, I have avoided telling them what I do for a living. Not because I don't want them to ultimately know I'm a pastor, but think about it. When we make the focus that we want people to learn about what we do, then implicitly we're kind of relegating the intrinsic person who we are to the lower end of the spectrum. Oh, I'm a pastor, that's what I do. Or, oh, I'm a small business person, that's what I do. I'm a doctor, that's what I do. But wouldn't it be really great if in the people you meet, you could hear them say, here's the things I value, or here's the standards I try to hold myself to, or here are the things that I really take ownership of in my life, or even something as simple as, here are my hobbies. So as I've met some new people, I've tried to tell them not what I do, but something about me. Let me give you an example of this. I was at the Holland Church about a month ago, and I was leaving, and I stopped at a coffee shop, a Bigby coffee shop. They're all over up in the Grand Rapids area. And I got myself a cup of hot chocolate, and the barista was chatting me up. It was evening. I was the only person in the place. And, he wanted to make conversation. And he gave me his name, and he asked for mine. And I said, well, I'm Brad. And then I said, and I'm a terrible skier. I thought he was going to spill the hot chocolate on himself. I mean, he was so flummoxed. He just looked at me for a moment, kind of deer in the eyes look, and said, I'm sorry to hear that. I went and got my hot chocolate and fixed it up and headed to the car and headed out. I plan to keep going back to that Bigby, and someday I will let him in on the secret of who I actually am. But for now, he knows something about me, the person, and not just what I do. I think we talk about what we do because we think it's safe. It's a little distant from ourselves. It gives us some small chit-chat conversation that we can go back and forth on without being vulnerable. Kind of a shame, though. When we do that, we start to define ourselves by what we do. And isn't that who we are as a culture? Here's what I do. And we think that's who we are. But aren't we so much more than the things we do? And also, there's this danger as well. If we define ourselves by, the job we do, then what's the next step to that? We define ourselves by what we gain from the job we do, our income. And then we define ourselves by the stuff we have, that we got from the income, that we got from doing a job. Have you seen this pattern in any culture that you are aware of? In a culture where we make jokes about he who dies with the most toys wins, I think we see that pattern. We live in a time and a place where what we do and what we make and what we have seems to be our highest value. And it's a shame. But then, on the other hand, we are not the first culture that has fallen prey to this. Oddly enough, at the moment in time when Jesus came and lived among us, he was a part of a culture that seemed to be trapped in a similar sort of cycle. People defining themselves by what they do and what they have and how much income they have, rather than their values, rather than by their sense of community. And in his famous Sermon on the Mount, Jesus addresses this. He wants to talk to people about, well, what's really important, their wealth or their God? And why are you all so concerned about the stuff you have? And really, when it comes to work, who are you working for in your life? And all of this kind of has become even more important for me in my sojourn in your midst in New Buffalo, as I'll share in a little bit. But for now, let's look at the scripture itself. It's from Matthew 6. We're going to pick up in the 24th verse. No one can serve two masters, for a slave will either hate the one and love the other, or be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and wealth. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food and your body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? And can any of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your span of life? Why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin, yet I tell you, even Solomon in all of his glory was not clothed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which is alive today and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? Therefore, do not worry, saying, what will we eat, or what will we drink, or what will we wear? For it is the Gentiles, the non-believers, who strive for all these things. And indeed, your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things, but strive first for the kingdom and its righteousness, and then all of these things will be given unto you. All this stuff about what we do and what we have and income, all of the agenda that seems to be a part of our life, well, it's not as important, is it, as the work we do for the kingdom of God? And Jesus is very clear, if you're willing to kind of put God first, put the kingdom of God first, if you're going to worry about those things, God will take care of the rest. So the challenge before us is to ask a kind of powerful question. Who do you work for? Because who you work for ends up kind of giving you a sense of where your values are with regard to your income and what your values are with regard to your stuff. Who do you work for? Because everybody works for somebody. First time I learned that lesson was years ago in an old John Wayne movie, which oddly enough, I couldn't sleep last night. I got up about 3 a.m. and it came on TV. The same movie I was using today came on TV at 4 o'clock this morning. Talk about life's little coincidences. If you don't know this movie, it's called McClintock. Don't go out and rent it. It's not that good. But there's a great little scene in there. John Wayne is a wealthy cattle baron. I mean, even the town he lives in is named after him. And he's got a young man who is working for him, and the young man is sweet on the cattle baron's wealthy daughter. And McClintock likes the young guy, and he kind of hopes it all works out for him and his daughter. But the young man has got an issue. he feels like he's not worthy of her because, you know, he's just a hired hand. And so he spills this to Mr. McClintock, John Wayne. He says, I'm a nobody. I'm just a hired hand. I just work for you. And Wayne looks at him in his classic kind of Wayne way and says, you've got some strange ideas, young fella. Not a very good Wayne imitation, but that's the best I got. He says, everybody works for somebody. You work for me. I raise cattle. I ship them off to market. I work for everybody in these United States who wants to have a T-bone steak. Everybody works for somebody. That really kind of came home to me when I was first integrating myself into this community. I noticed right away that the economics of our community were a little bit different than is common. Typically, you go to many places, you have a few people in the upper class, a large middle class, and a few people on the lower end of the spectrum. But let's have a little moment of honesty about the uniqueness of our setting. That big body of water over there has put us in a position where we have some people of means here, maybe a little bit more than the average. And as I think some of you are aware, we have a lot of other people who have less than average and a relatively small middle class. Jobs in our community aren't, you know, working at the factory. There's a few of us who get to be teachers or things like that, but a lot of it is, you know, kind of work this job, that job, and try to make the ends meet. I moved to a town not realizing that I was coming to a place where that everybody works for somebody was going to be right up there in neon lights for us to see. And it puts stresses on a community when it's like that. Families, when they're holding, say, you know, two or three jobs between two people, they struggle to make ends meet. They struggle to just be able to be involved in the community or to even attend church. And you see, a friend of mine years ago said, you know, I think New Buffalo is a picture of what the future of our society is going to be like. Fewer and fewer people able to afford kind of that middle class lifestyle. And all we have to do is check our news feeds or watch a little TV, and we realize that what a friend has said to me 20 years ago has kind of come true. We build a society on the notion that you do this work, you get your income, you get your stuff, and you've had a good life, and now that's not working anymore. And we got to find another way. You can't be somebody who works for your own agenda, whether you're employed by somebody else, you know, the agenda of do my job, get my income, and have my stuff, because it's not working. But then the truth is, if you really made your life agenda about money and stuff, that never really worked, did it? It really didn't. Because at the end of the life, you may be somebody who has a lot of stuff and a lot of money, or somebody with little stuff and little money, but if that's the greatest treasure of your life, it ain't much. John Milton, the great author of English literature, in his famous poem, Paradise Lost, has a moment where he is doing a description of hell, and there is Satan on his throne, and he is surrounded by, well, his lieutenants, you know, the people in charge of his demonic armies, and they've got, in the poem, you can see a list of their names, and here are some of them, Moloch, and Dagon, and Astarte, and Baal. If those names are vaguely familiar to you Christ followers out there, it's because those are the names of the demons in the Old Testament, the gods that were worshipped in the idolatry. And all of them are part of Satan's leadership. But in the poem, if you read it, there's one demon that sits at his right hand. It's Satan's number two, go-to person. Do you know the name of that demon? mammon, which may not mean something to a lot of us, but it's an old-fashioned word that means money. And if you ever read one of the older, more traditional translations of Jesus' speech here, such as the King James Version, it goes like this. No one can serve two masters. Either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. It doesn't work, this pursuit of personal wealth, because at the end of the day, we may get there, but we may feel hollow inside. It needs to be the balance. If mammon or money comes into our life, it's because it's there for God to give us so that we can put it to use for the reign of Jesus Christ. You see, the pursuit of mammon in and of itself for ourselves is really about making ourselves the center of the world and having all of it be about us instead of God. That's why at the end of the Paradise Lost poem, he has this famous quote, Milton does, it's attributed to Satan, where Satan says, "It is better to rule in hell than to serve in heaven." If it's about me, that's where I go. If not literally, then in the figurative sense that I'm so narrow-minded and so self-focused on what I have that I lose sight of the larger relationships that are available to me. Can't make it about the money, and you can't make it about the stuff. Because here's some truths about stuff. First, there is always somebody out there who's got more stuff than you. Always. You ever heard the old story about the guy who's driving the Yugo and the guy who's driving the Rolls Royce? Yugo, you know what it is, that little kind of car they were making in Yugoslavia for a while and importing here. It looked like Fred Flintstone's car from the Flintstones, okay? I mean, that kind of low-end car. They pull up next to each other at a stoplight, and the guy in the Yugo rolls down his window, and he looks over at the Rolls, and he says, "Hey, nice car. You have a phone in that car of yours?" The guy in the Rolls Royce, "I've got a phone." "Wonderful," says the Yugo driver. "Do you have a refrigerator in there? Because, you know, I got a fridge in my back seat." The Rolls driver, now getting a little annoyed, says, "Yeah, I got a fridge." "That's great," says the Yugo driver. "Tell me, do you have TV in there? Because, you know, I've got a TV over here in the other part of my back seat." And the Rolls driver says, "Yes, I have television in my car as well." And the Yugo driver goes, "Man, that's a really cool car." And the Rolls Royce driver says, "It is the finest luxury automobile in the world. There is none better." And the Yugo driver goes, "You have a bed in there?" Rolls Royce guy looks at him. "I mean, I've got a bed in the back of my Yugo." And then the light turns green and he zooms off. Well, I'll tell you, this upsets the Rolls Royce driver to no end. And so instead of going on with his day, he drives straight to the dealership where he has the dealer put a bed in the back of his Rolls Royce. I mean, he comes by the next morning and picks it up and it's perfect. It's superb. I mean, it's got silk sheets on this bed. It's that nice. And he gets the car and he decides, "I am going to go find that Yugo driver." And he starts searching all day long. And he finally, late in the afternoon, he sees the Yugo in a parking lot. The windows are all fogged up on the inside. And the Rolls Royce driver pulls up next to it and he gets out and he knocks on his window. There's no answer. So he knocks on the window, and he knocks on the window, and he keeps knocking on the window until finally the window rolls down, and the Yugo driver sticks his head out, and his head is just soaking wet, and the car is just, you know, steam coming out of the car. And the Rolls Royce driver says, "I want you to know I now have a bed in the back of my Rolls Royce." And the Yugo driver just looks at him in disbelief and says, "You got me out of the shower just to tell me that?" I've heard some good jokes in my 24 years here, too. It's always going to be somebody who has more stuff. The pursuit of stuff isn't what it's about, because the stuff doesn't last either. All of this, all this material stuff around us, it's transitory. So what does last? It's the kingdom of God. When I have seen our community at its best, it's when it's the people who are part-timers and year-round residents, it's the, when it's the people who have and the people who don't have, when it's the school teachers and the small business people, when it's all of us who say, we are in this together. Community. The reign of Jesus Christ, what is it? It's community, where people are living authentically to each other. And we're at our best when we're not striving for the stuff in our life or getting that money into our life, but when we're striving to better our sense of community. Jesus said it best. Here are his words, and I close with these. Therefore, do not worry, saying, what will we eat, or what will we drink, or what will we wear? For it is for the Gentiles, the non-believers, who strive for all these things. And indeed, your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things, but strive first for the kingdom and its righteousness. And then all of these things will be given to you as well. Amen. Please join with me in prayer. Oh Lord, I come before you today as a person who's at that place in life where I've got an agenda that's kind of long, God. I've got some packing to do, and I've got new things to start and other things to close out. I've got new pieces to put in place and other pieces to put in place in a different way. And yet, oh God, help me to remember, even in the busy times, that ultimately my best agenda is the one that's about you and what you have for our lives. If I live in a world, and Lord, I do, where it's about what I do and what I make and what I have, then I've got it as wrong as the people who lived in that culture that Jesus first spoke into some 2,000 years ago. Help me, Lord, to remember the lesson that everybody works for somebody. And then help me, Lord, to make the decision to work for you. Because all the wealth I can gather and all the stuff I can have, it pales in comparison to what I can have with you. And so I pray for my brothers and sisters here and for myself as we enter into a time of quiet centering and prayer. Lord, oh Lord our God, help us to lift up the needs of our friends and neighbors and the broken and the barren places of our community. Help us to pray for the injured and the hurting and the wounded who are in recovery. Help us to pray for the broken relationships and for the healing and mending and for our community, that we are drawn and bound more closely together, whatever backgrounds we come from. And Lord, help us to pray in confession, to name the ways we've put together agendas that are about the stuff and what we make and what we do, instead of agendas about what you've done for us, how you've shaped us, the values you would instill in us. Help us to name the ways we've gone astray. And then help our feet to wander back toward you. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Come into this room. Come into the hearts gathered here. Be present in each soul. First, helping us to not only name our woundedness, but also to know that your grace and mercy is poured out to every heart, and that you heal the woundedness. Come, Holy Spirit, come. And in your grace, lift our eyes to a higher presence and calling, to be about the work of kingdom and of righteousness, and to trust that like the lilies of the field and the birds of the air, everything else will find its place. And we know, Lord, that this great enterprise that we are a part of, this kingdom of God, is kind of a couple of steps forward and a couple of steps back, because we want so much to be your followers, but we know so much that we are flawed. And so we pray, God, that you help us to do our part and to trust that in your time and in your space, it will become that kingdom, that reign of Christ. And so may the actions we take forward from us in the week ahead reflect a desire to do your work. May the prayers that we lift up always build us and grow us in doing your work. And may you be with us now as we share the prayer of Jesus, which is all about the kingdom to come and what it looks like and what it feels like and how it is a glory that lasts forever and ever. And with his words we pray. Our Father, who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my daily bread. Jesus at the center of it all. Jesus at the center of it all. From beginning to the end, it will always be, it's always been you, Jesus. Jesus. Jesus at the center of it all. Jesus at the center of it all. From beginning to the end, it will always be, it's always been you, Jesus. Jesus,
nothing else matters. Nothing in this world will do. Jesus, you're the center. Everything revolves
center of my life. Jesus, be the center of my life. From beginning to the end, it will always be, it's always been you, Jesus. Jesus,
nothing else matters.
Jesus. Pray with me. May you be the beginning and the end, the Alpha and the Omega, the very center of our lives, so that our lives may be stirred for the fulfillment of your kingdom. Amen.